Hi everyone, I'm very excited to introduce you to the OpenDogNet. As you may have already understood, this is an app to identify the brink of a dog on a picture. What are we going to talk about in this presentation? Well, first of all, why did I make it? What was the goal? The theory behind, how does it work? The practice. We'll see it directly on the field, test it in real life, and then make the conclusion. Is it worth going for it? Maybe you should go for some non-free options. You can decide. So, what did I want to achieve when I started this project? Well, I wanted to create some artificial intelligence software, first of all, to identify with good accuracy the breed of a dog on a picture. Good accuracy means over 100 pictures, I get 80 correct guesses. And then I wanted to take this program and cast it in a lightweight app that could run smoothly on Android. Of course, everything using open source software. How does this work? Well, let's introduce a bit the basics of artificial intelligence. What is a convolutional neural network? How do we train it? And how do we put everything into a small file? Neural networks, how do they look like? Well, neural networks are an imitation of the network, actually, that is in our brain, except that are not physical networks, but they are simple mathematical operation, pieces of software. However, they are engineered in a similar way. We have processing units called neurons. They take an input, they give an output, and they pass the output over to the next processing unit, to the next neuron. Important is to note that not all the information is equal. Some informations are more important than the rest. So basically we select information by adjusting the weight of each. The weight is basically how a coefficient applied to the transfer of information. How do we use it for pictures? Here's an example for self-driving cars, let's say. Is applied to speed limits. So we have the image of the speed limit. We have to make the algorithm understand that is maximum 50. What do? We have categories for sign, let's say speed limits in general, and labels. That's why it's called supervised deep learning. We assign labels to categories and we feed the output into these categories, like a supervisor will do with a student. Then what we do with the network, we extract edges, say here is the corner of the five. We give a certain importance to selected images, so we adjust the weight. This is the corner, let's say is important enough. And finally, we make the classification. Based on the feature selection, we obtain a probability. We check if it corresponds to the right label. If it does, we make the right guess. So this is a sign that indicates 50. But how do we use this technology to identify dog breeds? How do we train it? So we feed the picture of a dog. Let's say that this is a chihuahua. Pass through the artificial neural network, it extracts information. Each piece of information has a certain weight that we can adjust. on and on. Then we go for classification. What do we obtain? For each breed, a certain probability. So we have four breeds. Chihuahua is the most probable, then is Basset, etc., etc. This is the supervised part. Those are the labels that we give. Labels are either one, correct, zero, not correct. Are we close enough? Let's say maybe yes, maybe no. But if we are not, we iterate over. We adjust the weight. Basically, we select which edges are more important, which information is relevant to have a certain good probability that matches the label, and we go on and on. So we do it four times, then we move to the next image of a chihuahua, select the edges, we update the weights, etc., etc., over for every image. So we did it, okay? We fed many images of many breeds. We have a fully trained neural network, and we can do at this point what is called transfer learning. So we have an image that has no label. We feed it to the network that we have trained. What we will obtain will be probabilities as an output. Image, network, probability. In this case, this is a Britain in Spain. But how do we do this in practice? We cannot just buy a neural network in a supermarket. First of all, I need pictures to train it on. Then I need to make a software understand that the pictures correspond to breeds. And then, of course, I need to manually code the software using, of course, libraries, some already written software. So, the data that I use for OpenDogNet. That was the Stanford dataset, available on Kaggle.com, is over 20,000 pictures. They are stored in directories. Each directory corresponds to a breed. You notice they have a bit funny names. So what did I do? I downloaded the whole thing. Using a Python script, I renamed the folders so that Australian Terrier contains all the relevant pictures, and the folder name is used as a label. Then finally, it was time to build, to code my deep learning software. I coded it using the programming language Python, and it was a bit complicated to do it on my local machine, but I could go and do it for free using cloud computing, precisely Google Colabs. So I can write here software, I run, and this processes it for me. It's a machine that is remote, is on another side of the planet, and I connect it over the internet. Okay, what did I do? I finally obtained a small file that I had to deploy to Android. Basically, as I got with Google Colabs my artificial neural network, I had to put it on my phone. For a small recap, it has to be fully trained, precise enough, over 85% accuracy, lightweight, otherwise Android doesn't want it, and has to work offline. I don't need any internet connection. What did I do? Build a CNN, train it on Colabs, then using the library TensorFlow Lite, I could not only do the training, but also convert and create a small file, around 5 megabytes, with an extension tflite, TensorFlow Lite. At this point, I needed another software, the one to deploy to Android, to basically to unbuild Android apps. This is Android Studio that I have here. And it contains here a folder, assets. That's where I could store the file created on Colab, and then run and make another file with an extension APK. This is basically an Android app that I could, for testing, put it in my Android phone, but when it was ready, I could send it to Google Play and let Google decide whether to put it into production and distribute it or not. Okay, enough with the theory. That's more or less how it works, but now it's time to go out and test it in real life.
Who let the dogs out?
Was nice, the party was bumping. And everybody having a ball. Until the fellas started in calling. And the girls respond to the call. I have a pull my shout out.
Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out?
So, how did it go? Well, I got a few good shots. Beagle, it got it, no problem. Again, our friends here at the viewport did a good job. I had also some mixed breed. Mixed breed means probability for one is good, probability for other is also good. So it can also detect this. Of course, it was not always perfect. This, for example, was a bit misclassified. The first probability was not correct. Was good the one, the second. It's not only the algorithm. It's a lot to do also with the quality of the picture. Good example is this one. Here there was the shadow of my bike. What did I do? I introduced artificially more edges. This confuses the algorithm. In fact, this gives me a wrong prediction, totally wrong, because it looks here. When I remove some of the shadows, I get it right. It is exactly the same dog, exactly the same app. So, for conclusions, we have seen that the deep learning model that I created using TensorFlow-Lite works pretty well. The goal, over 80% accuracy, was achieved, no problem. Then I could obtain a lightweight app. The app OpenDogNet is around 14 megabytes, and we can see that it does well for most breeds. Last but not least, I could tell that a lot of the dog owners got quite interested, asked me a lot of questions about the app and how it worked. So, also for humans, it's good and it's fun, it seems. Links in the description, so that if you want to dive deep in the code, if you want to understand better neural networks, there are already some suggestions. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. However, the story will not be complete without thanking at least who helped me with this deep learning adventure.